I will speak English and Alicia will speak Italian.
Ciao a tutti, benvenuti. Io parlerò italiano, lui parlerà inglese, però comunque parleremo molto, sì, diciamo due cose.
In April and May 2019, four artists, journalists and activists from Poland traveled along Central and Eastern Europe through Poland, Czech Republic and Slovakia within the framework of the project called Dance European Caravans to investigate the conditions of migrant workers in Central and Eastern Europe.
Nel maggio 2019, quattro artisti, attivisti dalla Polonia, nell'ambito del progetto Trans Europa Caravan, hanno viaggiato attraverso Polonia, Repubblica Ceca e Slovacchia per investigare sulle storie migranti, dei lavoratori migranti e di fare delle interviste e piccola ricerca sui diritti di lavoro di migranti che vengono da fuori dall'Europa a lavorare in questi tre paesi.
Manufacturist, the performance we are going to see in a minute, is trying to share this experience with the audience, as well as is trying to ask the question about the position of the artist within the world of work and the relationship between the work of the artist and the work of the worker.
Manufacturist, che è una performance che vedete adesso, prende uno spunto da questo viaggio di maggio, è ispirata alle storie dei lavoratori migranti che i membri della caravana hanno raccolto e vuole essere una riflessione tra connessione tra i lavoratori operai e il mondo artistico.
The factory's laborer is a human being. A factory is a symphony of sound and movement, of body and mind, a total audiovisual, a perfect synchronization of objects and movements, an actual theater of real performance. The beauty of a factory's performativity is infinite. Many attempts have been made to achieve something similar in theater, opera, ballet, to no avail. Actual factory work may take place only in the factory. Timing and choreography stem from the nature of work, not from anybody's intention. A factory worker is made into a denizen, a performer whose knowledge of movement is gained through work, not through artistic education detached from the reality of factory labor. Their body is subject to the brutal regime of the assembly line, timetables and daily labor norms. The force of this choreography lies in a daily routine. The task's irrevocability and the perfect automation of movement. This makes for involuntary beauty, a harmonious landscape, a complete work of art. A factory laborer performer is a perfect artist, as they have been created in the performative environment of the factory. Their workplace is a natural stage for living art. The proof of their dance work lies in its connection to life, especially the unconscious mechanical activity inherent in factories functioning. Laboral performer would not call themselves an artist. They are an artist. The magic of their performance is the fact that they are unaware of being an artist, an involuntary creator of art. Art that takes place beside them. This way, they do not act, they do not try to recreate any set choreography. The choreography is already in their body, programmed, encoded, and thus authentic and genuine. The laboratory performer and the factory create an audiovisual landscape, perfect in its uniformity. Monotonous, trance-like sounds of machines are on overture of the choreography of the laborer, who performs it almost organically without hesitation. Their disconnection from consciousness and mediative choreography make work into a ritual and let the laborer immerse himself in their body, become the body, and this way a perfect performer. A factory works according to a strict formula, a set of rules organizing the work of a facility. It is a perfect script, a detailed score for the performer at the assembly line. The factory, a magnum opus, with its intricate system of subordination, both subjugates the laborer, setting the rhythm of their work, and at the same time is fully dependent on them and their impeccable choreography and the assembly line. The awareness of the factory's supremacy over the laborer dancer has its impact on their choreography, generating different sorts of tension in the final version of their performance. It is a truly curious relationship. The factory, acting as a grand round choreographer, creates and dictates the movements of the laborer. It can move them around at the assembly line as it pleases and change their choreography while still being fully dependent on the labor dancer. An artist dancer could learn a great deal from the laborer dancer if they only understood the intentions of the latter's choreography. Thank you.
your beauty.
It never succumbs to outside influences, tensions, or dispositions. It perfectly fulfills its job. It is a mute participant in the factory's ritual, or, as Jerzy Grotowski would put it, a performance, a moment of fulfillment, an act. The machine produces sounds, and so it makes for a complete spectacle with elaborate movement and soundtrack. In itself, it is a looped, steady ritual. Its choreography is written in a programming language. It is an endless algorithm of movement, having no beginning and no end. An electrically powered electronic circuit, dependent on start and stop buttons and on the power supply. Its operator choreographer decides on the time and duration of its dance. They are in a relationship power with the robot, just like the factory is in a relationship of power with them.
The robot performer is a total one. The automaticity of its movements is exciting and its ruthlessness is terrifying. The execution of the robot's choreography is cruel because it is inevitable. Its movement is that of a mop, painfully precise and inhumanely punctual. The robot performer is brutal. If we were to put a human being in place of coachwork, it would cut and twist the human body with no hesitation. Dripping with blood, it would keep on working with no rest, no break, no second thoughts. The inevitability of the robot dancer's movements is terrifying, yet also satisfying to watch. Imposing and entrancing, it enforces compliance to the mechanized dance. Submitting the viewer's mind to a mechanical mantra, the robot performer inspires fear and respect. It dances no matter the consequences. It could be said that it loses itself in its dance, like a human performer would. But for a human dancer, such total immersion in their dance is temporary, a state they achieve only for the sake of the performance. For the robot dancer, it is permanent, indispensable, with no regard for time or the number of viewers. The robot performer, just like the laborer performer, does not care about any of it. It realizes its art whether we call it a performance or not. The movements of the robot dancer are dictated by the facility's work algorithm. Its dance is performed through and for the factory itself. It is teamwork with no teammates. The multiplicity of robots in one space by the same assembly line creates an illusion of a team. In reality, every robot performer is a huge individualist, every one of them self-sufficient. A perfect loneliness. The robot faithfully reproduces the sequences of its choreography without mistakes, without doubt, without thinking. Focused only on itself and its movements, ordained by the factory's program. The robot performer takes no responsibility for them. It takes responsibility for nothing. The robot performer is the ultimate bastard.
Thank you.
driver is a human being, and the factory is their place of work. Perhaps they hate it, or perhaps they do not care for it, but it is their place of work, nonetheless. The laborer's work in a factory seems romantic. This impression is accompanied by the Marxist myth of a great proletariat, a nation's force of agency and inspirations. The laborer dancer, a virtuoso of labor, a perfect soloist in an army of perfect soloists. So, do they remain a soloist? Their work is exceptional and unique, as is the work of other laborers at the assembly line. I would like to see it that way. I do see it that way. While the laborer is disposable, replaceable, repetitive, in the laborer, I see a performer skillfully executing the choreography of their work among the factory's scenography. While the performer is a worker, the choreography is work, and the scenography is the machine. None of this is play, none is a performance. The laborer does not pretend to be a performer, does not dance on the assembly line, does not await an applause, they just work. That is what they do. They will not be given flowers after 10 to 12 hours of work. After they leave the assembly line, they will receive no prize. No feet will nod to them. No one will care to shake their hands. They will just do their job and go home. That is all they were waiting for during the shift. Behind the elaborate dancer, there is a human being's story. Behind their fluid choreography, there is body, perhaps sleep-deprived, exhausted, longing, sick. The dance I watched for several dozen minutes, whose beauty took my breath away, is performed for hours in the factory, so that the laborer can survive, save up for a coffee or other indulgences. The music, which to me sets the rhythm for the choreography, is the hum of machines, atmospheric for a second, torturous for after many hours. It's easy for me to see a performer in the lab. I have been in a factory for several dozen minutes on an organized trip. We are walking around, watching it like a museum, a gallery, or a zoo. Everything seems so unusual, bizarre, exotic, and unique. From the insider's perspective, it is usual, dull, monotonous. The force of the factory routine, which turns the laborer into a performer, also turns them into ruin. The ceremony of the dance labor is dance macabre for the living. The factory is a symphony of destruction, of desires, dreams, bodies. The idea that a laborer cannot see the beauty of their performance is cruel. How cruel and gross are robots, which, without any thinking, perform mind-numbing tasks in an endless loop. The laborer dancer's body is a prison of monotonous movements. It is a choreography of brutal routine. It is a dance of death. In the factory, the body is disfigured, degraded, degenerated. It forgets it is a body. The factory dehumanizes the body. In the factory, a human being is a robot performer, a dancing machine.
I finish my cigarette. I usually finish my cigarette before I enter the gate. I take out the pass. Beep, beep, cleanse the machine and opens the fence. I get to the other side. It's 5:30 a.m. Before I enter the ballot at 6, in the locker room, I put on my green-white working trousers. Out of the locker, I take shoes. Those with hardened toe boxes, so that I won't mangle my feet. I put on a blue t-shirt with a Manpower logo on it. I put elbow-length gloves and mittens under my armpit. These are the kind of gloves that protect from hurt, but allow for sensing even the slightest damages on the car. When I stand on the belt, I put on protecting glasses, air filter mask, and earplugs. Before the foreman gives a sign and the belt starts running, I prepare my work clothes. On the table, I arrange a grinder, a file, and a special pencil to mark the damages on the car. I am responsible for examining the left side of the car and half of the roof. A colleague next to me checks the right side of a car. Except for me, there is one Hungarian, two Slovaks, and two Czechs in our crew. Altogether, there are 6 crews on a ship, and each one deals with different tasks. The bell is heard, which means that the belt is going to start any minute. I stand almost at its end. When the car rolls onto my station, I have 45 seconds. 45 seconds to check if the left side is free of irregularities and, in case of such, to fix it. I slide the pal against the surface of the car. If I sense an irregularity, there is no time to lose. If the defect can't be fixed on the spot, I mark it with a special pencil and let the car go on. This solution, however, isn't always good, because there are only 15 places in the space for defective cars. That's why I use the pen only if necessary. I prefer to repair most of the defects by myself. If I feel that my work will take more than 15 seconds, I stop the move of the belt. Every delay means falling behind the schedule, though. I know that the foreman doesn't like it at all. The plan has to be fulfilled. There are 450 cars to check during one shift.